everyone. Thank you very much for the invitation. I'm really delighted to present some of my lab's work here. So to prepare this talk, what I first did was to go back to François Jacob's book. I did read Le Jeu des Possibles a long time ago, and I went back to it. It's a short read. First of all, I realized I didn't understand it when I was a teenager. Second of all, kind of inspired me to actually prepare this talk and present it a little bit of a different way than I usually show my work. I really try to pay attention to the social aspect of microbes, which is not necessarily exactly directly what we study. And at the same time, I thought that François Jacob in this book, he was really telling us something about the constraints of evolution, really from kind of a molecular perspective. And I think he alludes to this physical aspect and how the physical world really constrains also the evolution of life. So I renamed the talk because of this reason, and I'm going to try to convince you that actually mechanics matter to the evolution of these microbes, and in particular in their social lives. And so first of all, I want to convince you that mechanics are around. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about the mechanics and the forces that these microbes experience. For example, I'd like to take the example of Pseudomonas aeruginosa. It's a really prevalent opportunistic pathogen that you find at the ICU and many other hospital settings. And Pseudomonas can primarily be found in soil, on plants. It's very common to get infected through wounds, and these Pseudomonas really like to form burn wound biofilms in particular that you need to get treated for. And when you get such infection, you need to go to the hospital and you end up contaminated medical equipment. And you ultimately carry this all the way to patients who are under ventilation and to their lungs. And then they can actually be affected by acute and chronic infections. During this lifetime and this changes in environment, you can see that it's very heterogeneous. Nevertheless, they experience many forces that are generated through experiencing different types of fluid flows, for example, in the lung or in soil, or adhesion forces as they attach to different substrates of different stiffnesses, be it the plastics and the soft materials from the medical, from catheters and respirators, or from biological tissues. Okay? So all in all, bacteria experience forces, and they do have to deal with it, and this is sometimes overlooked in many microbiology studies. And as a result, we're trying to resolve this. And we try to understand something about the environment, so mechanically, so we try to have kind of a physics perspective on this. How does it feel for a microbe to be at the micron scale under the action of a flow or to attach on a soft surface? And then we try to replicate that in the lab. That means that we need to be a little bit more creative, not only use the typical methodologies, so for example, the petri dish or the test tube, but come up with new technologies that will allow us to actually control the mechanical environment of microbes. So my lab is kind of a multidisciplinary team where we really try to develop these new methodologies, but at the same time, we really dive into the molecular and mechanism of how the microbes actually adapt to mechanics of the environment. And there's a lot of opportunities in that area. All right, so many of these mechanics actually arise near surfaces. So you can come back to this biofilm development picture, and there's a canonical model for this where the microbes attach to surfaces after they've been swimming around and looking for an environment that they would like to colonize. Once they attach onto the surface, they will experience these adhesive forces, so they want to stick there, so they essentially experience contact. And then they might start divide in order to form a biofilm, for example, or they might want to move around. And as they do so, they experience forces from the flow that's really prevalent in all aquatic environments. So these are called shear forces that really want to remove the cell, for example, from the surface. And there are also internal forces that are generated within this polymeric matrix from the biofilm structures and also from the contact with other cells. So the question, and the more general question we're asking, is how do the mechanics, the specific forces, actually contribute to surface adaptation or to other physiological changes from the microbes? So now let's go to the social part. So we know from people who work in microbiology fields that really these microbes are very social. So the previous picture was really showing you a generic microbe just growing on the surface. But now there's more complexity in like a real environment, for example, in our microbiota or in the plague biofilm. This induces different interactions between the different microbes that may want to engage into competition, which is very common, for example, competing for food, or for entering cooperation. And these different social interactions will lead to different special organization in a bacterial community, for example, in a biofilm. So there's a strong feedback between this spatial structure of a community associated with a surface and the social interaction that it will ultimately enforce. And so the question we're asking in this case is, how do the mechanics actually play a role in this process? Is, for example, flow or the mechanics of the surface impacting something about the spatial structure or modulating the social interactions? And if you come from like the mechanics perspective and you understand something about the mechanism by which these social interactions are enforced, you can actually come up with a nice hypothesis that you can actually nicely test using different mechanical probing methodologies. So today I'm going to show you a few vignettes about these different aspects of how mechanics can impact social interactions among microbes and communities. I hope I have time to actually show you everything, but in all these stories, we actually do a lot of studies on the molecular mechanism level, but I'm going to somehow overlook those. I'm going to stress a little bit more on the social aspect and how the mechanics couple with them. So first, I want to tell you about how flow can impact the spatial organization of microbial collectives. And we started getting into this because we had an interest in biofilms from this very interesting freshwater bacterium called Colobacter crescentus. We knew that Colobacter actually colonizes many environments in flow, so freshwater and streams of water and lakes. And we were just curious about the different strategies that it would actually take to colonize flows of distinct intensities. And so, for example, one of the first experiments that Tamara actually ran was to grow biofilms of Colobacter crescentus in weak versus strong flow, which is very much something we would do to actually gain intuition about the morphogenesis of this biofilm. And what she saw was, first, in weak flow, the biofilms form very rapidly, as you could see in this movie, in contrast with a strong flow biofilm experiment, where the colonies are actually forming. They form very nicely, but they end up forming very slowly in comparison. At the end of the movie, you can see that there's in the same amount of time, a very small proportion of the surface that's covered. And by looking at the movie, which are time-resolved here, we could gain intuition about the mechanism that by which these differences would occur. And something came to Tamar's mind that was linked to swimming motility, because she could see that the bacterium in weak flow were able to swim a lot, but we couldn't see really this in strong flow environment. So really, the flow really had a strong impact on the biofilm architecture. So we decided to come to physical aspects and physical modeling of this phenomenon to try to understand it from the mechanics perspective. And we went back to this idea of the dimorphic lifestyle of Colobacter, which doesn't divide like E. coli into two nearly identical daughter cells from a mother cell, but it uses an asymmetric division and a differentiation process to actually reach the ability to divide. So the mother cells are very sticky. They stick on the surface using this polar stalk and what we call holdfast, which is extremely strong glue. And then it performs fission to generate these daughter cells that are essentially shed into the fluid. And this daughter cell can either attach near its mother right into the direction of the flow, or move away from its mother and colonize other environments using swimming motility. So when this cell is in flow, it can swim. And when it swims in the absence of gradient, it swims in random directions. So it somehow uses like diffusive-like trajectories, and then it can land back on the surface. But when there's a stronger flow, it's actually carried away by the flow predominantly. And this is reminiscent of a problem in transport phenomena, and you can derive a non-dimensional parameter associated with the probability of encountering the surface that depends on the speed of the flow and the swimming motility, which is modeled as a diffusion coefficient here. And this non-dimensional number is very reminiscent of what we call a Peclet number in engineering. And this Peclet number happens to be very much used in engineering to quantify how much different solutes actually can mix into one another. And so with this intuition, we decided to look a little bit more into how flow can actually impact the spatial organization of these microbes, in particular in Colobacter, because that was the system we started working on. But again, I want to stress on the fact that in nature, we find this very much mixed communities of microbes. This is the example of a plague biofilm. These microbes can be found as isolated. So for example, this blue Lotropia strain is actually segregated from the Prevotella and the Streptococci strains that are essentially in green and orange that like to mix with one another, essentially. So again, I want to stress on the fact that the social interaction really depends and are coupled with the relative positioning, so the spatial organization of the different clones. And we want to know if now the flow impacts that, because we gain this insight from this mixing problem. And so when we mix two different Colobacter crescentus strains that are actually expressing two distinct fluorescent proteins, the identical strain backgrounds, they have no interaction socially. But just from the action of the flow, we can clearly see that in weak flow, they mix a lot from these diffusive-like trajectories that really scramble the initial organization, to strong flow, where there's a very strong spatial structure, where swimming motility actually is mitigated by the fact that flow is very directional and getting the cells out of the device. So here we're just showing confocal stacks at saturation of the surface, so there's no effect of the lower saturation of the strong flow environment. So at the end of the day, the flow really exacerbates the lineage segregation. Like this is something that is imposed onto future social interaction with these microbes. So there will be an impact on social interaction. Colobacter is, however, not super social. So we wanted to understand whether this flow could actually have an impact directly on the social interaction, and we decided to think a little bit how microbes can actually talk to one another and communicate with one another by looking into the chemical communication and chemical interactions between different clones of microbes. And this can be an effect that's going on through metabolism or signaling like quorum sensing. But one of the most social community of microbes that can be found on there is really the gut microbiota. So hundreds of species, very dense population that you can see here on this cross-sectional view. So this is an intestinal epithelium section. So you can see the epithelium here, the mucus layer that separates the microbes from the epithelium, and the dense community here labeled by fish. So at least we can see some spatial structure here as well. And there's many reasons to think that in response to the different dietary changes in the gut, these microbes will actually respond differently depending on the flow. And so we wanted to kind of highlight that in a real microbiota system. And so we took on the challenge to actually grow these microbiota communities in a macrophytic device and study them at a single cell level. And this is the work done by Jeremy. Jeremy was able to actually deploy these two different bacterial strains from the human gut microbiota, so both from the Bacteroides, so B. thera and B. fragilis. He managed to make a system in which we could actually see them using fluorescent protein fusions, so that are constitutively expressed. And then we can take this very large scale view of these biofilms and zoom in into the single cell as well and understand something about their organization in flow. But now we want these communities to actually interact as in they do in their natural environment. So these are two pictures that are from independent experiments in minimal medium with glucose, and both of them grow very happily. So now we wanted to actually identify conditions where they would actually share nutrients. And to do this, we had to screen for different carbon source conditions in, for example, which they would cooperate, for example, in which one of the species would actually degrade one of the carbon sources and provide a metabolic byproduct that the second species would be able to actually use for growth. We screened for many different polysaccharide possibilities, and I would like to point out to this frame here, the red frame, in which we were able to actually get Bithera to grow on this polysaccharide called dextran, which is actually found as a food additive in many industrial foods. It's also a fermentation product, so you can find it in wine, but it's not really a useful food for us. But B. fragilis fails to grow on it. However, the community, the co-culture of mixed Bithera and B. fragilis, all in test tube here, manages to grow. And if you go in an experiment where you will count how many, the proportion of Bacteroides fragilis, B. frag, and Bithera, you will find that only in this dextran condition, Bithera manages to catch up with, B. fragilis manages to catch up with Bithera growth. So they're essentially growing at a 50-50 ratio. So that means that B. fragilis cannot use dextran, but it can use the metabolic byproduct of dextran. So by itself, B. fragilis cannot use this polysaccharide, but Bithera can degrade it. For different analytical techniques, we demonstrate that Bithera produces glucose and secretes glucose as it breaks down the polysaccharide into metabolically accessible sugars, and this glucose is usable by B. frag. All right, so this is all in a test tube. What happens in flow under the action of a force? So let's look first at the co-culture in glucose only. So when these cells are actually not sharing anything, they're just competing for glucose. So they want to grow as fast as possible on this carbon source that's easy to use. You can see that they're actually growing together in green and in orange for B. frag. And they're actually quite mixed. And I think at the end of the experiment, we'll approximately get 50-50 percent of B. frag and Bt. They grow at the same rate. But now when we're actually making them cooperate, so we're forcing them to cooperate by feeding dextran to the Bacteroides theta biofilm, so that it produces glucose for B. frag. And we see that B. theta really wins now. Okay, it's the primary utilizer. But B. fragilis manages to grow as well. And actually, it grows in very nice biofilms that are highly structured. So there's not much mixing, but B. fragilis really manages to grow. And the second observation we have is that there's not much growth of B. fragilis at the front, but it's more downstream into the flow. We can really compare the B. fragilis, quantitatively the B. fragilis, to B. theta nearest neighbor distance. This nearest neighbor distance is showing you how much structure there is. So there's much longer distance in these clusters in dextran than in glucose, where there's a lot of mixing and most likely a lot more competition. So really here, the nutrient sharing is really structuring the microbiota biofilm, and the flow really impacts the relative positioning of these different microbes. But if we go further, actually the flow can push this all the way to actually control the composition of the community. And we discovered this by introducing and by further increasing the flow intensity. And so in this experiment, this is the same condition as you saw previously, excuse me, except that the flow is increased by a threefold factor, and you can see that B. fragilis fails to grow. In glucose, in the same condition, B. fragilis would still grow, so we would still get 50-50% of the both species, whereas the community of B. fragilis collapses as a function of flow increase. So at the end of the day, we know that increasing flow really pushes the glucose concentration landscape and transport the glucose out of the device, here the microchannel, to really reduce the community composition. So at the end of the day, we have our Bt, so Bithera, that's releasing glucose out of the dextran metabolism. If there's no flow, you can get this nice mixed biofilm without much structure. But the flow will transport the glucose metabolic byproduct from dextran degradation. If the flow is weak, we can get a special shift in the Bithera, in the B. fragilis population. But if you increase the flow too much, you can really get reduced diversity. So now I want to move on to the second phase of the talk, where I want to tell you more about the mechanics of the surface and how mechanics actually can impact not only the physiology of the microbes that they're colonizing, but also the spatial organization of this surface-associated biofilm. And this takes a specific, special meaning when you look at these microbes when they're growing actually in vivo on, for example, on human tissue, for example, on human epithelia, on the mucus. And so to first actually probe this type of behavior, a student of mine, Alice, she developed this macrophilic device with a very thin hydrogel film that we, from which we can actually really nicely tune the stiffness and the mechanical properties very accurately. And it's so thin that we can still do this nice high-resolution microscopy visualization of the microbes adapting to different stiffnesses. And so she started investigating this in Pseudomonas aeruginosa. She was very curious about different medical devices of different stiffness, and she deployed these two different PEG hydrogel of different stiffnesses, where she was able to demonstrate that Pseudomonas formed different types of biofilms on softer versus stiffer substrates. It happens that soft surfaces really stimulate this clonal biofilm growth, whereas the stiffer ones are actually really promoting this spreading of the cell. And it was obvious for us from these movies that the spreading was coming from a specific motility system in Pseudomonas that we've been working on for quite a long time, which are dependent on type 4 pili. And these type 4 pili are filaments that extend from the cell surface that are different from the flagellum because they have the ability to retract as well. So they act as grappling hook on the surface. So this type 4 pili really are extending and retracting through phenomena of extension and retraction via polymerization of protein subunits at the inner membrane of the cells. The cells use extension motors to actually polymerize and retraction motors to depolymerize, so these are ATPases. This is a very rapid movement that leads to this motility behavior, so this is specifically a flagellum mutant, so you can really just see the contribution of twitching motility and type 4 pili in this surface motility. So supposedly, when a cell wants to move using this type 4 pili, they will extend the pilus, attach it onto the surface, generate the retraction force, and pull themselves forward. So in the context of these hydrogels, we were able to actually track these cells over a long time scale. And then using these tracks, we can actually compute the displacement of different cells as a function of the different stiffnesses. And here you're looking from the softest all the way to the stiffest hydrogel substrate. And we're superimposing these tracks all together, and you can see that when the stiffness becomes very high, we get a very strong spreading of these cells. They just go much faster. And so this is clearly linking the twitching behavior to the different mechanically induced changes in stiffnesses. It's another way to tell me the end of the talk.
Exactly. Almost there.
Almost there, okay. I'm going to finish on this story then. So this was validated by looking at a type 4 retraction motor mutant that you see on the right. So the two first movies are the same as before. And on a very stiff surface, the mutant that cannot actually use type 4 pili is actually forming the same biofilms as the ones that you see on the soft surface. So we learned a lot about how this actually impacts antibiotic tolerance in the biofilm, and it happens that the condition in the middle actually the Pseudomonas is much more sensitive to the condition on the left. But then we looked into the spatial organization of the resulting biofilms. And again, we have this experiment where we mix two different species of that are expressing two different fluorescent proteins, so they're identical wild-type backgrounds, but expressing red and green fluorescent proteins. And what you can see is that the resulting spatial organization at the end of the experiment, so for example at 40 hours, we get very much clonal biofilms in the soft substrate, and there's very little mixing, and when there's mixing, it's really two biofilms that are adjacent to one another, but there's a lot stronger mixing when the cells are actually growing in much stiffer substrate. So ultimately, the substrate mechanics really now impact the relative positioning of these different clones that will enforce also different social interactions. So I'm going to try to stay on time and quickly finish with this other idea that this motility system in Pseudomonas twitching is mechanically regulated And it's not just a very passive motion that you can imagine where the cells go straight. We had many questions related to this. And it happens that we knew from a few years ago that Pseudomonas actually actively respond to surface contact, and they do so by upregulating many virulence factors, so they become more pathogenic when they touch the surface. I'm happy to tell you more about the nature of these changes, but what was very interesting about the mechanism by which they do this sensing is that they employ this type 4 pili and the retraction of this type 4 pili to upregulate these different virulence factors on the surface, but they don't use only this type 4 pili that are useful for motility, they also used a sensory system that's usually associated with chemotaxis to actually respond at the transcriptional level. So we've explored a lot of these aspects in my lab in the past few years. I want to go directly to this idea that this chemotaxis system allows these cells to actually deploy their pili at the right place at the right time in order to move forward. Okay, so in order to move, a cell doesn't make only one pilus, it makes many. If it were to make the pili on both sides of the cell pole, it would essentially go into a tug of war and essentially move back and forth. In order to move forward, like you see on these movies, they need to polarize this type 4 pili. Happens that they do this using this chemotaxis system that I just talked to you about. There are many subtleties to this chemotaxis system. I don't really want to get too much into it. What I want to tell you is that the main hypothesis was that this chemotaxis system had a feedback from the pilus, from the mechanosensing of the pilus to its motility behavior by modulating the deployment of the different extension motors. So I'm just going to take an example of this where we're looking at the motility behaviors and phenotypes of different mutants, key mutants, that were actually regulators of the mechanosensation here. So if you look at the wild-type trajectories of these cells, you can see that it's spreading nicely around. There's one mutant that we found was actually generating this kind of jiggly motion where the cells go back and forth. And then we had one mutant where the cells all move forward. And this has an impact on collective motility because it's exacerbated when cells actually encounter one another. So when a wild-type cell encounters another cell, it will tend to reverse because it mechanosenses its collision. But this mutant that seems to go forward all the time, it essentially runs into the other cell and doesn't really pay attention to it. So just picture that in the metro in the morning, that can be chaotic. Well, in fact, it can be chaotic because when you look at the collectives, the wild-type is very well organized. The cells manage to find one another in order to meet at the leading edge of these biofilms and essentially spread on the surface very efficiently as collectives. This mutant that doesn't have this ability to mechanically sense its neighbors is actually very good and much faster than the wild type at moving individually. But when it comes to collectives, it's very lousy. It just gets stuck in the back. Okay, so there's a lot of jamming, and these cells are really trapped in the center of the colony, and ultimately, the collective behavior is really inhibited. So this mechanosensitive control of reversal is a very interesting way for these cells to actually synchronize the individual motion in order to generate effective collective motion. Okay, so for the sake of time, I'll skip the mechanisms, and I just want to end on this idea that really the mechanosensing here of different neighboring cells and during encounters, mechanical encounters between different cells actually is mediating this collective behavior. And we're actually looking into more of the physical mechanisms of this mechanotaxis now. And I want to finish up, I want to stress on this new idea that we're actually trying to understand this type of phenomena in contexts that are closer and closer to human infection, and that's why we're developing these organoids. We did this with Knut on the gut aspect. Now we're doing this for the lung. So we're looking at this effect of collective migration on the mucous surface using transparent mini organs in the lab that essentially replicate the physical environments that microbes should be interacting with in patients, we think. All right. With this, I'd like to thank my team, and in particular, Marco, Lorenzo, Jeremy, and Tamara, who left us, so she's not there anymore. And I'll be happy to take your questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much.